Thank you, Philippe, for the introduction. And so it's I have watched a lot of number theory web seminar, but it is my first one as a speaker. So I'm very happy, but I'm a bit frightened by the perspective. Okay, so I will discuss so joint work mainly with Manny Acca, Manuel Lutti, and Andreas Wieser. And hopefully I will also have enough time to speak of extra development, which is also joint with Ricardo Menares, which I will briefly touch near the end. So I start very basically with an elliptic curve over a field is so an algebraic curve of genus one, and it has a plane embedding, and it admits a cubic equation, which is given here, at least. So it's in a simple form, because I have if one assumes that the characteristic is different from two and three, and otherwise it has more terms. Okay, so the elliptic curve has a basic invariant, like the discriminant, which is non-zero because the curve is smooth. And attached also to the discriminant comes the J invariant, which is given explicitly by this formula. And the J invariant classifies the elliptic curve up to isomorphism, at least isomorphism over the algebraic closure of the field, not necessarily over the field over which it's defined, but it will be sufficient for us. Also, I recall that the elliptic curve has a structure of an algebraic group. In the plane embedding, the group law is given by the usual chord and tangent construction, and the zero element is the point at infinity. So here are, I spend a lot of time of designing this picture, so I want to show them to you. And so this is the sum of two points, and this is the double of a point, which is constructed via a tangent. Okay. So this is the basic object we want to consider. And so when you have an elliptic curve, so an invariant is a ring of endomorphism of the curve, so of really group morphisms. So for me, the ring of endomorphism is really the ring over the algebraic closure, so not over the base field, so that this ring is really as big as it could be. So, and then you have basically three cases. So first, the ring of endomorphism is reduced to Z, and then it means that the characteristic of the field is zero. Then the ring of endomorphism could be bigger. If it is bigger than Z, it can be an order in an imaginary quadratic field. And so this order, which I will write by OD, it's Z plus a multiple of the ring of integer of the quadratic field Q of square root of D, and the multiple is the discriminant divided by the discriminant of the field called the fundamental discriminant. And in that case, one says that the elliptic curve has complex multiplication by that quadratic order. And then the characteristic can be either zero or positive. And finally, the last case is when the ring of endomorphism is rank for the module. It is maximal order in a quaternion algebra. The quaternion algebra, so what happens is that necessarily the characteristic of the field is positive, so say it's P. So then the quaternion algebra is the quaternion algebra which is ramified at P and infinity, so which is definite and ramified at just at the prime P, and the ring of endomorphism is a maximal order in this quaternion algebra. In this case, the curve is called supersingular, and in fact, it admits an equation isomorphic to a curve defined over Fp square. So I will pass now to the case of positive characteristic. And then, so I assume that my field is containing the complex number. I choose an embedding. And then the complex point of the curve can be identified with Riemann surface of genus 1. That is the quotient of C by lattice lambda. And this identification is via the map which to a map which to an element in the torus, in the complex torus, associate the value of the Weierstrass P function and its derivative. So it gives the two coordinates of an affine point. And so if one wants to look now at the ring of endomorphism of the curve, then it becomes a ring of endomorphism of the lattice in C, that is the complex element which preserve the lattice under multiplication. Okay, and so now for an elliptic curve over the complex numbers, this curve has a complex multiplication, if and only if the ring of endomorphism of the lattice is precisely the quadratic order in the quadratic field, is a quadratic order of a quadratic field embedded into C. So in particular, if you have an ideal relative to this quadratic order, so I ask the ideal to be a proper ideal, so that is that it is not invariant by any bigger quadratic order, then the elliptic curves which you obtain by quotienting the complex by the a minus one, maybe I will just think it's a, or it could be a minus one, then this elliptic curve has a complex multiplication by this quadratic order. And conversely, any elliptic curve with such complex multiplication is isomorphic to a curve of that shape for some proper ideal. So, and in fact, what happened is that if I write L of CMD to be the set of isomorphism classes of elliptic curve with complex multiplication by this quadratic order, then this set corresponds bijectively with the Picard group of the order, that is as a set, the proper ideals modulo homotheses. Okay, this K, sorry, yeah, this K is not the initial K, it's not the base field of the elliptic curve. It's the really the quadratic field containing the quadratic order. Yeah, sorry for this collision in notation. Okay, so And so here is, so this talk will be a lot about Duke equidistribution theorems. And so here is the first of Duke theorem, of Duke's equidistribution theorem. So I, so if I called ELC to be the set of all elliptic curves over C modulo isomorphism, then this this modulus of elliptic curve is naturally identified with the modular curve that is the quotient of the upper half plane by SL2Z, and this bijection is simply to an element in the upper half plane. You associate the lattice, and then you associate the torus quotient. And if you work out this bijection in the case of CM elliptic curves, what you find is that the CM elliptic curves by the order ODE correspond to the point in the modular surface of that shape, so minus b plus I square root of d over 2a, where a, b, and there is a third number c, satisfied the discriminant equation, b squared minus 4ac equal to d, and we also ask that a, b, and c be coprime. So here what we have is that we have a primitive representation of the discriminant d by the vector abc, by the vector abc. So we have this bijection. So the set of CM elliptic curve by ODE is a finite set of points in the modular surface. And Duke's first theorem tells you that when the discriminant grows among the imaginary discriminant of quadratic imaginary quadratic orders, the set of CM points, which I would call the Egner points of discriminant D, is equidistributed on the modular curve. And, so equidistribution is with respect to the hyperbolic measure. Do you see my hand when I move it? It works? Okay. I never know. Okay. So, and this is what the equidistribution means for any compactly supported function continuous on the modular curve. The average of the value of the function over this CM points of discriminant big D converge to the measure, hyperbolic measure of the function. So, yeah, so here is a picture of some, so Egner points of discriminant, of this discriminant.
Philippe, can you get back one page?
Yeah.
What is small d, h sub small d?
Oh, it's a big D.
Thank you.
Okay. That's an easy question. Okay, so now I want to discuss something else, another version of Duke's theorem, which is the reduction of CM elliptic curves. So take CM elliptic curve. So far it is a curve over the complex numbers. But what happens is that the J invariant of this curve is an algebraic number. And this implies that E has an equation with coefficient in the algebraic number, and the curve is then defined over a number field, which is the number field generated by this algebraic number over the quadratic field of complex multiplication. So it's called the ring class field of maybe discriminant D. And moreover, but this field is Galois over K, and the Galois group is isomorphic to the ID class group of the quadratic order. So this is a form, a very explicit form of the reciprocity law for this extension. In fact, you have more. This Jain variant is an integer, and this means that the elliptic curves has potential good reduction at every place, at every prime. And so what you can do is you take a prime, a P, and then you fix a place over the algebraic closure of Q, which is above P. And then what happens is that, so then you can reduce your elliptic curve modulo that place. And by reducing the coefficient of the equation of the curve modulo, say the ideal determined by the place in any field of definition for the curve. And if the prime is inert or ramified in the quadratic field, then the elliptic curve E modulo P is super singular, and I recall you, it means that its ring of endomorphism is very big, it's a maximal order in a quaternion algebra so ramified at P and infinity. And if the prime is a split, then the elliptic curve has ordinary reduction. But we will here we will really focus on a super singular reduction. You can do is you can fix a prime P, a place above P. And I consider the set of all super singular elliptic curves over the algebraic closure of the finite field FP modulo isomorphism. And then what we have is a reduction modulo P map. So I write it red P with a little P and not fracture P because I have chosen my place, so it depends on the P with the choice. And so I take my elliptic curve, I reduce it modulo P, and I obtain a super singular elliptic curve. And also, when you have this reduction, what comes with it is an embedding of the ring of endomorphism, so of your quadratic order OD, into the ring of endomorphism of the reduced curve, which is this OP, this maximal order. And is it okay? Is there any question or okay? Good. So here is another version of Duke equidistribution theorem. In fact, it's a version which maybe can be attributed to a joint work of Duke and Schulze-Pillow. And so Duke Schulze-Pillow equidistribution theorem implies the following. So now I consider imaginary quadratic discriminant D. I let them grow. And what I ask is that the D's are all coprime with this prime number little p. I am also asking that this prime number is inert in the quadratic field containing the quadratic order. And then you can take all the CM elliptic curves by D of discriminant D and reduce them modulo p. And so you obtain a multiset inside the set of all super singular elliptic curves. And what happens is that when the discriminant D grows, So you have a multiset with high multiplicities inside this fixed finite set. And then this multiset equidistribute with respect to an explicit measure on the set of supersingular elliptic curves mod P. So this measure is the measure which is a probability measure which to any supersingular elliptic curves associates a mass which is proportional to the inverse of the size of the group of units of the of the size of the group of automorphism of the elliptic curve. Okay, so this is the measure for each atom in this finite set. And so what does it mean is that when the discriminant grows under these conditions, which are almost which are necessary, almost necessary, then the number of elliptic of CM elliptic curve with a given supersingular reduction, this number is asymptotically proportional to the measure of the elliptic curve up to the size of the whole set of CM elliptic curves. Okay, and maybe if you want to think of elementary consequence of having a given reduction modulo P, so what it says if big E reduce to little e modulo P, it means, and it's equivalent to saying that the J invariant of E is congruent to the J invariant of the supersingular elliptic curve modulo the place. Okay, and okay, so I will come back to this later, but now I want to give a theorem. And so what we can do is that we can fix a finite number of primes, so P1 up to Ps. We will consider discriminants which are coprime with all these primes. And also we assume that we consider only discriminants such that all these selected primes are inert in the quadratic field. And so when you have this this data, so the primes, the PI are fixed, and now you take a sequence of discriminants with suitable congruence conditions and coprimality condition, then you have a multi-reduction map. So you take your elliptic curve, CM elliptic curve, and then you can map it first. You can look at its at the complex number in the modular surface. So I will call this number red infinity E. And this number belongs to this point module belongs to the modular surface. And then you can take the various reduction of your elliptic curve. So red P1 of E up to red PS of E. And they belong each to one of these factors of super singular elliptic curve modulo PI. And so here is a conjecture is that when the discriminant goes to infinity, satisfying the condition that I have mentioned, which are natural, then this set becomes equidistributed on the product relatively to the product of the measure, so the hyperbolic measure and the supersingular measures. Okay, so that's a conjecture. And there existed one case where this conjecture is true, and it was due to Christophe Cornu. He was inspired by a previous work of Naik Vatsal. And so Cornu established this conjecture when the discriminants are of the shape the Fondan discriminant time given prime to an even power, so the given prime is fixed and it has to be different from all the PIs, and then you let the exponent n go to infinity.
Can you clarify? I mean, you say inspired by Vatsal. Vatsal used Ratner, of course, in his absolutely. Work. Cornu probably used some form of André Oort. Is that correct? That's a special form, yeah?
So Cornu, he had two proofs of this result. So Vatsal, what he did, he proved an equidistribution theorem for the same super singular locus, ELP, but he had a shift, multiplicative shift. And Ratner, he proved the equidistribution and the product. And Vatsal.
I want to emphasize the input. So Vatsal used.
Vatsal used Ratner. And then Cornu had a proof of this theorem using also Ratner.
But then
he came with another proof using André Oort also.
Yeah, okay. But I think it was a very special case of André Oort.
Oh, yeah, sure. Absolutely. Even
in other words, it was known before the proof of André Oort. That's what I'm trying to clarify. Yeah.
But I'm not sure that the André Oort proof gives equidistribution. I don't remember.
Okay.
It may just give surjectivity or...
But then maybe the thing to emphasize is Ratner then.
Yeah. Okay. So yeah, the key input in I was going to say this later, but the key input of the work of Cornu and Vatsal, it was the use of Ratner theory of joinings for unipotent flows. And absolutely. So now I want to give another evidence for this, so which is so this theorem that we established with many Manuel and Andreas. So it's exactly the same context as before. And so what So you need to take two further primes in addition to all the PI. So one needs two other primes, Q1, Q2. And then what one do is that instead of taking all the discriminant which are naturally involved in this problem, you restrict to the subsequence of these discriminant, which are also split at Q1 and Q2. And then for this sequence of subsequence of discriminant, the conjecture holds, so you have equidistribution. And so again, if you want a relatively concrete consequence, you can look at the congruence for the J invariants. And then you will, so what you get is a kind of asymptotic Chinese remainder theorem for the J invariant of CM elliptic curve. Okay, so you can reduce the J invariant to anything you want, which is natural, simultaneously for finitely many fixed primes. Okay. And I wanted to point out that towards this conjecture, there is no another evidence, which is the work of Valentin Blommer and Farrell Brumley. And Valentin gave a talk, one of the very first talk in the seminar, I think it was in the beginning of it was this summer in June, maybe, or I don't remember. So it was, so what they prove is that if you assume that the generalized Riemann hypothesis hold for a certain number of L function, which I will describe later, What you have is that the conjecture is true without splitting condition modulo Q1, Q2, but you have to restrict to two factors. So either for the product of the modular curve and say one set of super singular curves, or two sets of distinct super singular curves. So and so the method is really very elegant. So and it is inspired by some earlier work of Radziwill and Steve Lester. So use really crucially the Riemann hypothesis. So this conjecture has a number of special cases which are known.
Perhaps you should clarify the Riemann hypothesis, I assume, for automorphic L functions so as to get to half integral waveforms.
They need it for all the Rankine-Selberg L functions that occur in Waldspurge formula. Basically, they need really all the Rankine-Selberg with all the characters of the torus.
Just to clarify, but then through Waldspurge, yeah.
Yeah, it's through Waldspurge, and I will come. I will try to describe the various elements of the proof. Yeah. So.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
So in this Bloomer-Bromley theorem, mod d tends to infinity along an arbitrary sequence, or
yes, exactly. That's the point. The sequence of discriminant is arbitrary modulo that it's adequate. So it means that the d have to be inert at p1 or p2 whenever there is a p1 or a p2. But beside this natural compatibility condition, they do not need an extra hypothesis for the quadratic field to be split at Q1 and Q2.
Do they need a Riemann hypothesis or just Lindelöf?
No, they need Riemann. They really need to take the logarithm of the central value.
Okay.
Thank you.
It's very subtle. So it's because what in the end, what the saving that they obtain, they take a moment of the absolute value of a product of L function, and basically they save a power of log over the trivial bound. So it's a very, very delicate argument. So Lindelöf, I don't think it would. It's too coarse to. Yeah. And it uses the expansion of the log of the central value. So. Okay. I will recall some principle of the proofs. So the first proof of Duke theorem, it was via theta functions. So it's the principle is that these theorem were about a problem of representing integers by ternary quadratic form, or they all reduce to this. So I introduce some notation. So you have a three-dimensional quadratic space, VQ. I will call G its orthogonal group, and then you inside your space you take a lattice on which the form is integrally valued, and then the set of representation of an integer by this quadratic form inside the lattice, this is just the set of element of the lattice taking the value d at against the quadratic form. You may also need the primitive representations. Okay, so it's just a notation. And then what this is about is this set of representations has natural symmetries, which are given by the stabilizer of the lattice inside the orthogonal group. And so what one wants to study is either the set of representation or the quotient by this group G of Z. And okay, so what happens, say, for the first theorem, so the one for the modular surface, the situation to which it corresponds is when the quadratic space is the space of trace 0, 2 by 2 matrices, the quadratic form is minus the determinant. In that case, the orthogonal group is isomorphic to PGL2. And the lattice is this lattice of trace zero matrices, so Z times the identity plus twice the integral matrices. So, and then, so if you compute and parameterize the element of this lattice, what you see is that this set of complex of Egner points, it corresponds to up to maybe some scaling, it corresponds to the set of the set of classes of representation of D inside the lattice for this quadratic form. And so then, so what you prove is that if you scale the classes of representation, it will equidistribute on the corresponding quotient of an hyperboloid, which is precisely the modular surface. So, and to prove this, Duke used the correspondence of mass he showed that the Weyl sum for this equidistribution problem are equal. So I write equal if I take proper normalization, it will be inequality to the diff Fourier coefficient of half integral weight mass form. And then the objective usually is to show that this Weyl sum converges to zero if the function of zero mean. And it follows from showing that this Fourier coefficient is bounded by a quantity going to zero with D. Again, it all depends on the way you want to normalize the Fourier coefficient. It's just made to simplify my formula. And this non-trivial bound for this Fourier coefficient of half integral weight mass form, it was obtained by generalizing a previous work by Henrik in the holomorphic case. Okay, so here is a picture. Here is a picture of the equidistribution and this hyperboloid. So you see the fundamental domain being covered by Egner points. And okay. So maybe I will just quickly explain what happens for the reduction, the supersingular reduction. In that case, the quadratic space, okay, there should have been a zero here. The quadratic space is a space of trace zero quaternions in the quaternion algebra BP, so it's three-dimensional. The quadratic form is minus the norm, so just like minus the determinant. And then the orthogonal group is the projective group of units of the quaternion algebra. And then the lattice, so it's Z plus twice the maximal order, and you take the trace zero element, and this lattice is called the gross lattice after Dick Gross. And so for this problem, what you need to consider is not all the representation the discriminant by this quadratic form inside the lattice L, but you need to include all the genus classes of this lattice relative to this orthogonal group. So this is, and this was worked out in by Duke in joint work with Schulze-Pillow. Okay, and maybe just I explain how you pass from elliptic curves to representation in lattices. It is the fact that if your CM elliptic curve reduces modulo, I said it already once, I think, if it reduces to a super singular elliptic curve E modulo P, then this reduction induces also comes with an embedding of the ring of endomorphism of the curve inside the ring of endomorphism of the reduced curve, which is OP. And then how do you get a representation? What you do is you take the image of the element square root of D, which has trace zero inside the maximal order, and you get a representation. And then you want to study the set of all classes of this representation along all the various genus classes. And again, you have an equidistribution problem to which, for which you have to bound the Weyl sums. And these Weyl sums are Fourier coefficients of holomorphic modular form of half integral weights. And Ivanek provided the non-trivial bound when the for any large enough weight, maybe 5 over 2, and Duke provided a bound also for the low half integral weight. Okay, so now I want to pass to another idea for this proof of equidistribution, which turned out really to be crucial to the proof of the multiple reduction theorem. So really the approach through theta function or this theta half integral weight form is not sufficient to obtain multi-equidistribution results. And one needs something which is more dynamical. And the origin of this dynamics is again in the work of Gauss. So it's the following thing. So let's go back to a CM elliptic curve with complex multiplication. So it has a complex torus. It is associated with a lattice with these properties for its endomorphism ring. And then what you can do is if you take any proper ideal A, you can form the lattice of all the multiple of element of lambda by the element of A. So it's a lattice, and this lattice, it satisfies precisely that its endomorphism ring is again OD. So you have from an elliptic curve with complex multiplication by OD, you have obtained another elliptic curve by multiplying the lattice by a proper ideal. And then, in fact, this the new torus up to its isomorphism class depend only on the class of the ideal in the ideal class group. So, in fact, what Gauss proved it was not in this language, but he really proved this is that the set of CM elliptic curve with complex multiplication of discriminant D is a torsor under the action of the ideal class group, of the Picard group. So it's more precise than just being a bijection. It's really that you have a group acting on that set simply transitively. And it's 15 minutes, 50. Oh, okay. Okay, so, but then what is important is that the image of the reduction of the CM elliptic curves, either infinity or modulo P, can have a purely group theoretic interpretation, and which is very important. But for this, it's really convenient. In fact, it's an absolute necessity to pass to the Adelic language, I think. And the point is that the spaces, the target spaces we are interested in, can be realized as Adelic quotients, where the group is the orthogonal group for all these problems. And so it's an Adelic quotient with adequate compact subgroup, so possibly with a compact at the infinite place. And so you have really an identification of these sets with such quotients. And in this identification, you can also realize the set of the image of the CM elliptic curves. So for this, you have to consider this algebraic torus. So the restriction of scalars of K to Q of the projective group of this restriction of scalars. And if you have this data Z of E associated to an elliptic curve or the reduction of these elliptic curves, these data, they provide you with an embedding of this torus inside your group, your orthogonal group. And then the under this identification, your sets can really are identified with an orbit of this embedded group inside the Adelic quotient. And so these are various, this is important for various things. So one of these is a Waldz-Purge formula, because this formula, so this formula of Waldz-Purge, which has this shape, it tells you that the veil sum under, once you have this identification, it tells you that the square of the veil sum for the equidistribution problem you want to solve is related to the product of a central value of an L function and a product of local integrals. And so now, if you want to bound the veil sum, it is sufficient to bound the central value of the L function. And this, in that case, it was solved, this bound was obtained by Duke, Friedlander, Ivaniec, and to bound all the local integrals. And then I think it was Clausel and Unmoe who were the first to really prove Duke's theorem in Adelic language. Okay. At least that's the approach that they took. I want to say that there is another formula of Waldz-Purge, which is more general, in which you have this veil sum, but you can, in this integral, you can also add a character of the torus, and you have a similar formula, and this time these L functions are Rankine-Selberg L function. And this general twisted formula, it has several applications, but one very nice explication is precisely the work of Blomer and Bromley. They use a form of delta symbol method, very neat. And but for this, they need the GRH for all these L functions. So you see, it's a case where to have an equidistribution for the product, you really need to exploit the existence of a group structure. And here, they exploit it in the form of this twisted formula, where you can also include the characters of the torus. With the theta function approach, you do not see this. The veil sum, they come as a block. And I don't know how to do it with metaplectic forms, but anyway. So I will pass on this, and maybe I will try to explain what happens for our theorem. I wanted to explain Linick, but okay. So now, maybe to quickly finish, Now, if we want to look at the multi-reduction equidistribution theorem, what you can do is that the product of, say, the spaces of supersingular elliptic curve, you can realize it as an Adélie quotient, where the group in the Adélie quotient is just the product of the various orthogonal group for each factor. And then it's a quotient with a compact subgroup, which will be the product of the compact subgroup for each factors. And then if you have an elliptic curve with complex multiplication, you have the multiple reduction of your elliptic curve. And once you have these multiple reductions, it determines you an embedding of your torus inside the product of these groups. So, and it's a diagonal embedding. So T is one dimensional, which is embedded into a higher dimensional group. And you also have a torus orbit, which is the one formed by the Adélie data attached to each of the individual torus orbit. So there is a slightly non-trivial point still that you need to see, is you need to show that this torus orbit, this diagonal torus orbit, is indeed the image of the, correspond indeed to the image of the of your complex multiplication elliptic curve under the multi-reduction embedding. And it's not totally obvious. In fact, to see this, so this is true, but to see this, for this, you need an algebraic version of the action of say the ideal class group on the CM elliptic curves. So we realized it in elementary wave through complex lattices, but Serre, in his short article on complex multiplication, he also very quickly introduced what is called the A transform. And again, it's an algebraic version of this action. And it's slightly incorrect, but I will say it like this. Then what you have is that the reduction mod P of the translate of a curve by an ideal A is the translate by the ideal A of the reduction mod P. So of course you have to make sense of this star, but it's possible, it was done by Serre. And once you have this, you are sure that this orbit indeed represents the diagonal reduction map. And now what to conclude the proof, what do we have? Suppose now we have our sequence of discriminant with this primality condition. And suppose we give ourselves two extra primes which are in which all these quadratic fields split. What you obtain from this Adélie realization is a sequence of probability measures which are supported along this diagonally embedded, along translate of this embedded torus. And the splitting condition, such that Q1, Q2 split in this quadratic field, it tells you that these measures, sequence of measures, maybe up to taking subsequences and by compactness argument, you can say that they are invariant under conjugate, under fixed conjugate of diagonal elements, diagonal matrices of that shape. So so Q1, all your quaternion algebras, they are split at Q1 and Q2, because the torus is split at Q1 and Q2, so they are isomorphic to matrix algebras, and then you can, your group can contain such diagonal matrices, or their projective image. And in addition, your measure mu d they have by the previous discussion, by Duke's theorem, basically, when you project them on each factor, their limit, the limit of the projection is a measure which have a huge invariance, so which is invariant under this group G1, which is the image of the group of quaternions of norm 1, so the simply connected cover of PB. And if you have this and this, so then you can really invoke, so it's an invocation, like a black magic, a theorem of Einsiedler-Lindenstrauss, which tells you that, so this such sequence of measure has its limits, limiting measure, which are called the joinings. And Einsiedler-Lindenstrauss have classified the joinings for a measure which are invariants by such pairs of elements. And so then they prove that any weak limit is invariant under the product of the simply connected covers. And now to finish really the proof, it's not so much because to conclude what you have to do is the last function you have to look at are the characters on this group. And then it's really elementary to evaluate these the torus orbits against these characters. And because in your situation, the open compact subgroup is big, you can finish. So you don't have a pathological problems which could occur in that case, like exceptional subsequence and things like this. And so just I want to finish because I wanted to quote the joint work with Ricardo Menares. So I wanted, there is a recent, very recent work of Sebastian Herrero, Ricardo Menares, and Juan Rivera Letellier. So they have studied a more refined version of the reduction mod P of this reduction, super singular reduction theorem. So how can it be more refined? So for this, you have to know that in fact, the set of supersingular elliptic curves is just the indexing set of disjoint union of p-adic disks, say of radius one. And each of these disks, what they do is they parameterize the deformation of the formal group attached to each of these supersingular elliptic curves. And if you have an elliptic curve with complex multiplication and with a given supersingular reduction, the formal group of that elliptic curve gives you a deformation of the supersingular formal group. And then you get a point on this p-adic disk. So what they did is that using Duke's original method, so using theta series, they have established that the CM points are equidistributed on this disk. So the answer is more complicated than over the modular curve. What happens is that the limit depends, in fact, of the valuation of the discriminant. So you take a sequence of discriminant with valuation at P as a given value, and their theorem will tell you my set of such CM elliptic curve equidistribute according to a measure which are a certain support in this unit p-adic disk or this union of p-adic disk. And and you have a different measure for each valuation. So, and they did it with the theta series approach. And as I explained, it's, I don't know how to do a multi-reduction theorem, refined of their kind. So we learned a lot from Ricardo Menares about just already how to formulate this. And so with Ricardo and so many Andreas and Manuel, we could we have implemented the torus orbit approach, so to be able to obtain a result for multiple factors, at least for discriminant which have a zero valuation at any of the primes. And and then we have equidistribution for the product of measures, of the unramified measures, I would say. So here is an elementary consequence of this. So you, what, so for any, so you fix a finite set of prime, S. For each of these prime, you fix a CM elliptic curve over the complex number, say, whose discriminant is coprime with each of these prime. Of course, you need two additional primes for the splitting condition. But if you have all this, what you can show is that if you take a large enough discriminant with adequate condition, including the splitting condition, then you can always find a CM elliptic curve by this discriminant whose J invariant becomes arbitrarily close to the J invariant of the chosen CM elliptic curve. Okay. And so again, just to conclude the proof of this, it's okay. No, I will just stop here. Okay. I think I have this. Okay. Thank you.